थैंक यू। ओम गुरुब्रह्मा गुरुविष्णुः गुरुदेवो महेश्वरः गुरुसाक्षात् परब्रह्मं तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। सकनावधु सकनौपुनक्तु सकवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमुत्साभहै। ओम शांति शांति शांति। सो वी आर इन द सिक्स्थ सेशन ऑफ द वेदांत दर्शन। सो एज यूजुअल वी विल जस्ट हैव अ वेरी क्विक रीकैप। I think we have covered quite a lot. So in the future recap, I'm going to just make it to the last session instead of going back on the full thing of it. What is the goal that we have gone so far is towards the fulfillment or moksha. We need knowledge. So we first saw the enormity of the human birth. We are the only one who can set up goals and pursue it. No other life form can set up goals. Therefore, Purushartha is a privilege. And then we identified that there are two sets of Purushartas we have. The prayas, which is the Loka Purushartha, to get the Arthakama desires and the basic needs in a righteous way. But then we realized that the Loka Purushartha takes it to an entrapment, a samsara, in a vicious circle. Therefore, we said we must find a way to exit this entrapment. That's what is called Shreyas. But Bhagavan calls it beautifully called Loka Sankraha in Bhagavad Gita. So when prayas is your own well-being, for your own family, your own goodness, which is good, which you need to follow, Shreyas is for everybody else. That means there is an element of sacrifice. So when the goal shift from selfish reason to the universal reason, there's an element of sacrifice needed, introduced. And that leads to the Paramapurusha, which is called a moksha. Then we said moksha is, if it is liberation from a prison, I don't feel I'm in a prison right now, I don't want a liberation. Then therefore we look for the other definition of moksha, which is fulfillment. Everybody said, yeah, I need fulfillment. Therefore, it is okay for us, even though we are not fully evolved, at least myself, we can take moksha as to mean fulfillment, which we all need. Therefore, we shift to a goal that from now onwards, our goal is to fulfillment in everything. Then we learned the reason why we don't have fulfillment is because there is ignorance. So the ignorance is called avidya. So we will know the avidya in more detail. For example, if you go to the Yoga Shastra, Patanjali will say avidya, raga dvesha, klesha, abhinesha, and so on and so forth. So we can simply take right now, avidya is an ignorance which does not show or does not allow us to see our full potentiality. Which means, any knowledge we get in this world, if it is not showing the true self of yourself, then that knowledge is avidya. This is Shankara's definition. So vidya or Sri Vidya is the one which makes you know who you are. So avidya is the one which does not make you even to wish to know who you are. So avidya will be always a monkey on the shoulders. Even when you do the Vedanta discussion, which is all about vidya, avidya will be just knocking your back. Oh, that word is wrong. This word is wrong. Go somewhere else. It will drag you out of the course of focus. Then we looked at the knowledge that we need. We quickly look at it. That there's a process in this knowledge. It's called Triputi. The one who seeks the knowledge, one the object of knowledge, and the process of knowledge. So without going too much deep into this, we define the terms. Prama means knowledge which conforms to truth. So the definition is very important. We will call from here and onwards in this Vedanta, knowledge is that which conforms to truth. Therefore, we had a problem. So all that we see in this world are facts. Facts are not truth. Science is a fact. So therefore, in the world, we don't deal with truth. We deal with facts, which is essential. Like sun setting up in the west is a fact, not the truth. But it's good enough to go to bed. So we use the fact. Life is full of factoring things. It is perfectly fine. But the truth, when you want to know, we must have the knowledge which gives the truth. The instrument of knowledge is called pramanas. Then we saw three pramanas, the anumana pramana, the pratyaksha pramana, and the sabda pramana. Pratyaksha pramana is, now you are listening to me, I am telling something, you can hear something, it can give you some knowledge. Or you touch something, hear something, smell something. But anumana is, you use this pratyaksha pramana knowledge and you derive a new knowledge. A smell of jasmine somewhere there, you infer there must be jasmine. But can anumana pramana be valid? Maybe. Because it still needs to be validated. How do you validate it? You go there and see there is actually a jasmine flower. So every pramana gives you some knowledge and you must take another pramana to validate it. But when you come to the Vedanta, where we are talking about ourselves, we have no way of knowing by pratyaksha pramana. If you don't have pratyaksha pramana to know God or know yourself, anumana pramana cannot help. Because anumana pramana sits on the pratyaksha pramana's basis. Therefore, we need something else. In the world, we go to find some truth to a teacher. I gave an example last time. If you want to go to Heathrow Airport, you don't know the way, you go and find somebody who is trustworthy and ask him how to go. It's called aptavakya. Someone who thinks he may be trustworthy. Then you put Shraddha on him, or you take the Google map as an aptavakya, you go follow the Google map and find out. This is okay for the laukika world, in the worldly sense. But the man is all full of blemishes, so therefore his word, the man who told you the way to Heathrow, maybe in a deluded mind, he may be telling you the way to Luton, for example. In good spirit, but he may make a mistake. Therefore, in the Adhyatmika Vishayam, Laukika words are not good enough. That's why even the great teachers don't say, I tell you so. No, they refer to something else. What is that? It's called Shabda Pramana. It's called Veda, Shrutis. So we talked about it. And then we said, it is Shraddham because it's Veda, Shruti. It's Apurusheya, the words of the God. Why do we say that? We say that because then you will have Shraddha. Shraddha means accepting what is being heard, even though it doesn't conform to your knowledge. If you don't have Shraddha, you will jump away from the second class from Vedanta, because Vedanta is going to change everything upside down. Normally we are in this house, houses in the street, street in the city, in the town, in the world. We are part of a world. Vedanta is going to turn it around. No, my dear friend, the world is in you. So everything is not going to conform to a knowledge, present knowledge. Therefore, you need Shraddha. To have a Shraddha, you can't listen to any teacher, no matter how tall he is in this world. But you need something esoteric. Therefore, the jnana comes from the Vedas. Then we saw, to go to that ultimate knowledge, we need to have some discipline in life. That is also coming from the Vedas, in the first part of the Veda, called Veda Purva. In the Veda Purva, we talked about how does it give you the dharma, how to lead a life. And then we talked about the Varna Dharma, Ashrama Dharma, and all that. And then finally, we ended up saying, we need to be doing Karma Yoga. This is not Vedanta yet, but this is a step to Vedanta. If you do not do karma yoga in life, we can't go evolve anywhere. This is the fundamental first step, kindergarten. So, Visa karma yoga is to do things so that our life can be better, this world, another world. You know, just now we heard this Atala Utala Patala Lokas, down there, Loka upwards. All these Lokas are a creation. If you want to go to Vaikuntha, so there is a Loka, Swarga, there is a Loka. So we must have buy the ticket, the visa, the passports. So you need that to do in this world by doing karma. So the what karma to do, how to do that, all comes from the karma kanta. But what has it got to do with karma yoga and karmas? Because you do karmas properly, rightly, you get the passports and tickets to go to all the worlds, enjoy upwards if you do good things, downwards if you do the bad things. But you'll come back to the junction, the world. This is called the prayers. But if you want to go out of this world, that to be with God or be the God, then you need to make the karma into karma yoga. Then we said the definition of karma yoga can be two words. We try to pack a lot of things into this short lesson, so you read further if you want to. So karma yoga is just two words. I would say three words. One's right actions, the right attitude. The once is very important. You can't do something beautifully but not doing your duty. Bhagavan spends a lot of time to Arjuna because Arjuna wants to escape and become a sannyasi. So Bhagavan says, you know, your jnana is more important, not action. By the way, go and fight. Jnana is superior. By the way, go and fight. Jnana is liberation from samsara. Go and fight. Arjuna get confused. Why this man is just confusing me? If jnana is good and sannyasi is the jnani to jnana marga, why am I fighting? He want to ape somebody else's life. And also in ordinary life we do that. You know, we don't do our nitya karma. We don't do what is needed for our work and home. But we will do somebody's work. Because we want glory somewhere. This is papa. So he says once. Then we talked about right action last time. So this time, that's why we finished last session. We do what is right attitude. So just a quick recap on the right karma. I'm going to just rush through this. Right karma, what is the checklist? Karma is action, any action that you're going to do. You don't need to do any Vedas. Just know yourself what action I want to do. Is it a vigita karma? Is it something mandated to me to do? For example, sandhya vandanas, to do prayers. Yes, it is. I don't need to go to check any Vedas. I don't need anybody's advice. Just do it. No question asked. Your parents would have told you what nitya karma is. No, it is not about that. It is not something mandated karma. Then you check. Is it prohibited karma? Is it something I should not do? I want to gamble. Am I allowed to do gambling? Is it right? You don't say, I want to kill somebody. That's not an action. So forget that. You're talking about those temptations that you have in life to do something where you are not clear. If it is a nishita karma, of course not do it. Never do it. So it is not nishita karma also. Then what it could be? It could be a prayachitta karma. I'm doing a prayachitta. I made a mistake. I'm doing a prayachitta. Very good. We already talked about last session. Prayachitta is a karma given by the Vedas. But it should be used very carefully. You only do it if the prayachitta, if you don't do it, it will affect somebody else. If it's going to affect you, don't do prayachitta. Take up the pain. Therefore, you check, am I doing it because it's going to help me? No, it is for the lokakshema. It's called nishkama karma. You made a mistake, you want to correct the mistake. If you correct the mistake, somebody else will help benefit. Do that. No question asked. But if it is not for somebody's help, that the paishita karma falls into a kamya karma. It's your own desire. I never do sandhya vandanams. I don't do tarpanas, for example. Somebody says, one day he'll hear that tarpana should be done to the ancestors. Oh, I made a mistake. And he told me, if I don't do tarpana, I'll become a donkey in my next birth. I don't want to be a donkey. So what is the prayaschitam? I must go to the temple, do 200 namaskarams. I go and do it. You can do it. It's of no value. The remedy is, you continue vigita karma. Forget that you made a mistake. Continue the next time, you take it up. But my desire is not all this. This is about me going to a movie today. It's about buying a house, getting a new job. This has nothing to do with the Veda. Then it is also a kamya karma. Can I not do it? Of course you can do it. If you don't do it, how can you survive in this world? But to do as a karma yoga, the kamya karma, that the ordinary things like buying things, earning money, singing for somebody else, getting fame, all this to be analyzed, because you analyze by your gunas. If it is sattvic karma, that means karma done for good cause, even though it is for your own desire. I want to buy a nice house so that I can house my parents, aged parents, in a separate room. Go for it. Or I want to do satsang, I want to do bhajan classes, you know, like some of us are doing, sevas. Do that. That's a rajasic karma. Sattvic karma. Do it. But rajasic karma is for our own needs, our selfish need. You have to do it, but minimize it. Control it. Tamasic karma is karmas that you do, even if it doesn't give you any benefit, it creates harm to somebody else. So this man is going somewhere. I would like to make his job a failure. I do something. Why? Because I don't like him. That's evil. Tamasic karma. I said no to that. So this is the kind of right karma. So you can take it up. Then now we talk about right attitude, the second part of the karma yoga. Again, I will give a checklist of it. We don't have much time. I'll go through around quickly. So before starting any task, before talking any task, I think somebody can mute. I think there's a lot of noise. You discriminate and deliberate on the action. Why? Bhagavan already told you, right? You have the adhikaram, karmenasya adhikarishya. You have the right to decide what you want to do. So you decide, go through the checklist. It's a good attitude. Sattvic karma, rajasic karma. Check everything. That's the first attitude. Once you started, now you decided. Once you decided and started, absolutely interested in it, in doing the job. Total focus, commitment, and completion. You complete it. You never undo anything at any cost. Now, this is all common sense, right? So any job you think about it many times. Do I start this new bhajan class or satsang class, or do I participate in it? Why should I do it? What is it? Once you decided, come in, participate, show keen interest, have a total focus, commit, and complete it. That is an attitude. So when you do that way here, you are already doing karma yoga. Most important, when the job is finished, dispassionate about the outcome. Accept whatever comes. Now this is a very taboo in many things. Because people translate, don't expect the results, and that's the action you do. When Arjuna takes the arm and Bhagavan says, aim at Drona and let the arrow go, Arjuna should expect the arrow goes and hit his heart, the enemy's target. Can somebody mute? I think it's a lot. Okay. So what it is that you expect a result, but there's a difference between the action giving a result and the outcome of the action. I'll give an example. I'll give simple examples. So somebody just, I think I told the same example last week, simple example. Somebody dropped the purse, you pick up the purse and give it to them. You expect them to say thank you, and they didn't say thank you. You get upset. You see? So the action is giving the purse, is that person getting back the purse. The result has to be there. You have to be focused on the result. An action without result is useless. So many people translate Bhagavan's slogans like this: do without expectation of result. No, you must expect results. The outcome should not have privilege on you, right on you. So somebody steps on you, you get very hurt. That person doesn't say sorry to you. See, even though you don't do action, but then you realize that person is blind. The once you know, your compassion comes to you. See, with the avidya, when you do not know, it hurts you. But when you know, you become very divine. So knowledge is always revealing. Do you understand? So it's very important to differentiate between the outcome and the result. Now, how best to do this? I mean, this is a very big debate, you know. Karma Yoga is very difficult to understand. Somebody asked me, I think Narayanan asked me, can I not ask for a promotion in the job, salary increase? No, you do. I mean, whenever hungry, can I not ask for the food? Of course you ask for it. The needs need to be done, no problem. This is about manasa tapa. What hurts your mind? Your psychological privileges, right, that you're exercising for it. The best way I would say to know how to do action in Karma Yoga is imagine that you have to repay a debt. You have a mortgage, very pressurized mortgage that you are paying, right? Imagine you have to pay the last endowment, the last premium you have to pay. How would be your attitude to that? You got the money, you're going to pay the last premium. What do? You just go and pay. Done. I've done it. Do you expect anything after this? No. The very action is fulfilling to you. Because you are paying the debt and it is off your shoulders. It is your job to do. You must do. You give it away. Expect nothing. We can put that in every aspect of action. It is a debt that you owe. When you say a slogan, when I talk about something from Vedanta, I owe the debt to the Rishi who gave this one. It's called Rishi Rinam. Why if people like Balaji started preaching, teaching lessons, has he not got something else to do? He realizes there's a debt that we owe. The immense treasure is given. So we must propagate. So when you must learn, you must read. So same way, when you do karma, you deliver that as a debt to somebody else, you'll be fulfilled. Every action from now on that you do should be that. So you do that, how do you prepare your mind for that? You do as an Ishwara Arpanam. See, when Arjuna takes a bow and arrow and leave the arrow out, he may be a wonderful, great warrior, no question about it. But there's no guarantee the arrow will go to the target. The wind may change. Like if Krishna is on the opposite side, he may press the chariot down and it may not hit. So the end result is not in your hand. See, everybody wants to win a marathon race. All our devotees, they pray to God, Shiva, Vishnu, Ganesha, let me win this race. What does God do? Who is he going to give it to? So therefore, everything that you do has to go to God. God has to take it and say, okay, this is his action, his action, his action. I have an important job. I am Dharmakarta. I must make sure everything in balance. Therefore, this guy does this one, this will affect this part. Therefore, I'll give him this much. But can he give arbitrarily? No. He will say, what have you accumulated in just the Papa and Punya? I'll give it to him that much. But can I take all his Punya and make him win this race? No, he cannot take it. I'll give him a little bit, let him come third. Or let him fall down, let him not win, because he has got a better thing to do. He must study for the exam next week. So anything that you get is not from your action. It's coming from somebody else. Therefore, when you do something, you are giving to God. Now, if you are inviting me home, or not me, somebody who you love and you respect, you invite me home, you want to give the best food to them. Clean up the house better. All the rubbish go inside the under the sofa. He sit them well and feed them well. Because you want to give the best to them. So if you're giving to God, what do? You give the best to them. But it is not in a once in a while home art at house or puja at house where you wiped in the silverware. If you can do every karya, every action as a worship to God, what happens? Your action becomes pure. Your reverence will come. Work becomes worship. I remember someone told me some time back, I don't know where I heard this one, it's a wonderful anecdote that there was a person who was in Madurai, a very old man, a taxi driver in those days. And if you asked his life, and he said only one thing he remembered, because when Mahatma Gandhi came to Madurai, at the town in South India, he was the driver. He only talks about it. I was the one driving the car for Mahatma Gandhi. Why does he remember that? Because he did that day as Ishwararpanam. The moment you know that you are doing that for someone reverential, you know, saintly, even God, then the job becomes so beautiful. So when you come to this class, when somebody talks in this class, or somebody goes do something, if not only this class, even your regular job you do, your employer has to be seen as a God. Not in a ritual sense, but in the divinity in that. So you do Ishwararpanam, therefore your benefit is you become more purer in your execution of the task. And the benefit is the Ishwara Prasad. See, if I go to Natuji and give them, okay, this is a laddu I made at home. He says, oh, thank you, Sahaja, and he put it aside. Because he may be diabetic, he doesn't want to eat it. Or he knows that I don't make good laddu, whatever. But if I say, this is from Tirupati, it doesn't even go to mouth, it goes to the eyes first. What happened? Same laddu, once it becomes a Ishwara Prasad, it gets reverence immediately. This is all happening in our day-to-day life. We are capable of doing all these things in a kshana. In 1 minute, we can all become karma yogi. But it is to hold on to that thread that I will do from now on every karma as a right karma, as a Ishwararpanam. And wait for that as Ishwara Prasad. Okay, I got 10 more minutes. So, if you do all these things, I'm wrapping all this because this is not part of the Vedanta Darshana, but this is something which we will start cultivating in ourselves. Because you know, all these things should give transformation. All these weekly classes, when COVID is finished, we are busy with our day-to-day life. We don't spend time as much on the satsang. This should not be a memory that you have, a good memory you have. Useless. It must be something which you are transformed now, today. So you have to take this and practice it every day. Because Vedanta, if you don't practice it, if you don't see it in a day-to-day life, It is so difficult to understand, so useless to study. Let me put it that way. Everything have to be put in practice going through. So, two benefits you get. Chitta Shuddhi. Remember these words, we need to really look at it very deeply when you go to Vedanta. Chitta Shuddhi is about pure mind. Drada Buddhi is a resolute intellect, unwavering intellect. These two will come by doing Karma Yoga. Can you believe it? You are not doing any special exercise, just doing the right thing, the right attitude. Your mind becomes purer, your intellect becomes very sharp. So every child should do, because it makes you strong in your studies, in your doing things. But you need to have persistent effort, because it'll be forgotten tomorrow. Not tomorrow, maybe the next 1 hour. So you had to take effort to do this. Why it is, because Bhagavan says, in the Bhagavad Gita, he says, Dhumena pride vaknir yatha dasho malechinas. Dhumna means smoke. Abhigyate means fire. Like a smoke covering the fire. Just like that, a mirror covered by the dust. Yatholpe nabrito garbha. Like the child is covered in the womb. Tathate nidam vritam. So ignorance, the ignorance of not knowing who you are, covers you. God gives you three examples. One example is a child in the womb is entrapped. Other example is dust is covering the mirror. Other example is smoke covering the fire. I say this because the effort that you need, the time you need to wait for the revelation depends on where you are in your character. If a child is inside the womb, inside the fluid, there's no way the child can come out just like you want it to come out. You have to wait patiently. Nothing else you can do. So if some of our karmas are so strong that we cannot understand, appreciate, but we have little desire to know, but efforts are not coming up, just be patiently wait. Just be part of the satsang. Don't worry if you don't understand. Don't worry your mind is not motivated to try. Don't worry you don't follow prayatna. Just be in the satsang. Like someday the delivery will happen. But you are able to see, but you are very active. You have so many other things to do. After this you need to play cricket. You need to organize another a meeting for something else. You do social seva. You're so busy, man. So you can't really put time on this. It is like a mirror is your mind, your knowledge about Atma, but dust is covering it. So you don't need to wait too long to clear this. You can clear it very quickly. Some effort you need it. But you must do it very often, because dust will keep on coming. So when you are a rajasic mode, where you are too activity, too many things, Vedanta cannot grab you so quickly unless you put an effort of cleaning the mirror of your mind persistently, often. But the lucky some of us may be there within the group, within the community, who is more focused on the Atma Jnanam. The fire is there, the light is there, the warmth is there, but still they may have a smoke of Satvik Desaya. You don't need to try anything. The God's gentle whistle, a breeze, will just take the smoke away. You may have a question there, therefore, even the Satvik mind, would they have the coverage of the, would they have the impediments like this? Yes, of course. I want to do this puja, that parayanam. I need to go here. All these are satvishyam. But you are like smoke. You don't need all that. But you will do. So in depending on who we are, how we are, we have to really put effort to get that flame of fire of knowledge. So you practice in life. So I am going to draw the line here about the where the purva, but giving you an exercise, just not for me but yourself, that perform Karma Yoga. If you want to know more about that, just focus on the chapter 2 and 3 of the Bhagavad Gita. Of course, you can just simply live with what we discussed here, learn more. We don't talk about this anymore. So if you have any doubts, I mean, there are a lot of scholars in this group, you can ask them and get knowledge from this. But important thing is not the knowledge, but the practice. From the Veda Purva to go to Vedanta, then there is a second part, which is about the Upasana part. The Upasana is when the karmas are done in the mind. Every action that you do is in your vocal, in your voice, in your body, and your mind. So when you come to the point that I am doing all the actions, but mind is not at rest, the mind is not having the focus, it longs for the satsang. So what do? Then you take upasana, japas. So you, when you are really stressed up, oh, I want to go to meditation class, I go to the some of the ashramas, I take a 15-day course, sit straight, breathe, long breathe, up breathe, slow breathe, nothing going to happen. See, if you, even the great people, like, you know, when you do tapas, Ravana, just now we heard about Hiranyakasipu, he was a great tapasvi. He did tapas many, many years. Tapas is upasana. Focused mind. What happened after this? He remained an Akshasa. Somebody may be sleeping, and while sleeping is so beautiful, calm and serene. When he gets up, he comes back to his own devilish character. So just because you sit in a tapas, upasana, meditate, japam, and your mind is focused, when you get up, you are going to be the same person you are. It doesn't help at all. Why? Because focused mind is only a second part. Chitta Shuddhi is the main part. If all the asuras have been had Chitta Shuddhi, their steadfast focus and tapas would have made them all Brahmas and gods. Therefore, don't jump to the japam and tapam and all this thing, meditation, all this, before you have certain perfection in your Karma Yoga. How do I know that I am doing Karma Yoga? First one is, every time you do something, the checklist comes to your mind. Am I doing the right attitude, right work, right attitude? If you are thinking about it, okay, maybe initially it may be deliberate act that you have to do it now as deliberately. But once you become familiar, like, you know, it's like Andy Murray, when he hits a backhand, his backhand comes naturally. He doesn't think, turn right, put your elbow to the 45 degrees and swing. You know, he doesn't do that. It happens naturally. So it comes naturally. Every action you think, it is satkaryam. So then you can go japam and meditation and tapas. That's why when you do the contemplation and tapas, for some reason that your thoughts may come into you and it may drag you into the devil's gate, they give you a rope to hold on to it. What is a rope? A Divya Nama. Say Rama Nama, Krishna Nama, a mantra. See, even when you say mantra, what happens is, mantra got too many words. And between words, there are gaps. Mind will escape through the gaps. Escape through the words. The word will be a great upamana of Valmiki. Then your mind will go to the Valmiki's upamana on that word and then jump onto that one. It's fine, but it is not the purpose. So if you crash all the words into a simple nama, Rama, Shiva, Krishna, then your dilution part is limited. You come into that nama. Anjaneya was sitting there next to Rama. And Anjaneya was closing his eyes and do Rama, 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 Rama. Sugriva got very amused. Look at this Hanuman. The very Rama that he's asking for is sitting next to him. He's closing his eyes and doing Ramanama. He asked him, why are you doing this? I said, this Rama will go, but my Atma Rama can never go. To understand the insight, like Bhagavan Ramana was there, he was sitting and standing the windows, and he normally stands. My father has told me this, and he was with him for a while. And Ramana was holding the windows and standing all the time, and somebody asked him, what happened if Annamalai come in front of you? And Ramana said, Oi, inda maadhi velayalam vachikadhinga. In English, don't do this kind of magic to me. He's a jnani. What he says is that any form that comes in will go away. Any form is limited. But the name is better than form. Name has got a name has no spatial dimension. It's got a temporal dimension. It decays in time. There's no spatial dimension for it. So it's better than the form. So instead of worshipping a Rama statue, Alekna Thyagaraja regrets when his statue was thrown away, he was remorseful. This is like a smoke of this fire, you know. My Rama is gone. So his Ajnanam that time come in as a smoke on his actual Jnanam. But then he realizes Rama Nama, why should I worry about this statue? At some stage, even the Nama has no meaning. So what we do, we will do a little bit of essential part of the Yoga Sutra, only those part, because there are not really Vedantic adherence to that, but there are some part of it is there that we will do. So I think I come to the time now. So I would stop here. I wanted to take something else more, but I think I will stop it here. So what we have done is conclude the Veda Purva. So you should, if you just go back on the previous lessons and read through it, you may have some questions, you may find some mistakes. Feel free to exchange. But take a pratigna, because subsequently I think we will stop building in the text, and then we started going in deeper. It makes much more, because all this we learn, you can only validate yourself. To validate within yourself, you should not validate with your Brahma. You know, Brahma means wrong perception. Not with your mind, which is impure. So therefore, because you need to validate what you learn to yourself, your instruments of learning, which is the mind, the instrument of validation, which is the mind, have to be perfect. Therefore, there's no point if you don't practice it, but just keep on accumulating knowledge, you will not be able to validate it. If you don't validate it, you won't get benefit out of it. Therefore, to validate, take it from now on, if it's not already done, that Karma Yoga practice, Chitta Shuddhi as a practice. So let me close it here. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.
Om Asato Ma Sadgamaya.
Asato Ma Sadgamaya.
Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya.
Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya.
Mrityo Ma Amritangamaya.
Mrityo Ma Amritangamaya.
Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
Thank you, everyone, and thank you, Raja.
Thank you.